For 2 months, ever since he left the White House, John Bolton has been silent on Twitter. That all ended today with a string of tweets teasing for his followers to, quote, stay tuned, that his backstory was more to come. But moments ago, the biggest bombshell, this is what he just wrote, quote, "We have now liberated the Twitter account previously suppressed unfairly in the aftermath of my resignation as national security advisor," and also blaming the White House for keeping it under wraps. But while Bolton is taking it on Twitter, he isn't talking. He's not talking on Capitol Hill, most specifically, where after 2 weeks of testimony, partisan sniping, and clear signs that congressional Republicans will not budge in their defense of President Trump, two key words loom for House Democrats and their impeachment inquiry. What's next? CNN congressional correspondent Phil Mattingly is live on Capitol Hill. Caitlin Collins is at the White House for us this afternoon. And Caitlin, let me just start with you on this John Bolton, you know, tweeting. How's the White House responding to this?
Or not tweeting. We've asked the White House for comment on this, Brooke. They haven't gotten back to us, but this is a pretty fascinating accusation from the former national security advisor, who is tweeting again now repeatedly today, accusing the White House of blocking his personal Twitter account after he resigned as the national security advisor and left the White House about 2 months ago. Now, he just tweeted again moments ago saying that they blocked his personal account. Look at this tweet here that he said, essentially laying out what he believed it was that the White House did, saying that they are not letting him tweet or use his personal account. I believe we have that tweet from John Bolton saying that they refuse to return access to his personal Twitter account. Quote, "out of fear of what I may say to those who speculated I went into hiding," he says, "I'm sorry to disappoint." Now, to add to this drama, the president did a nearly hour-long interview on Fox News this morning where he was asked about a former tweet that John Bolton had sent, asked if the White House had blocked Bolton's account. The president said, "no, of course not," but then Bolton went even further with his accusations here, and now there are more questions that the White House right now is not answering. But of course, Brooke, this is all more interesting, not just because people have been missing John Bolton's tweets, but also because he is not speaking on Capitol Hill, even though his attorney teased that he has some potentially explosive information that those Democratic investigators over on Capitol Hill do not know yet about what is at the center of this and this pressure campaign on Ukraine to carry out these investigations that the president and his personal attorney Rudy Giuliani wanted. That's something we're still waiting to see if Bolton is going to be a witness to that, if he's going to come forward and speak. So far, we do not believe so. And while Fiona Hill, his former aide, was testifying, he was spotted by John Berman walking down Fifth Avenue in New York, not keeping a close eye on the hearings by any means.
Okay, we're going to come back to John Bolton in just a second. But let's big picture this for a second, Phil Mattingly, because when we look ahead but also think about what's happened the last couple of days, Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy tells CNN that not only will he keep Republicans together, he may get support from some Democrats when the full House votes on impeachment. You tell me, is there any nervousness on behalf of Speaker Pelosi, her team, as they plot their next steps?
Yeah, so the short answer is no, and I think they probably wouldn't appreciate Kevin McCarthy trying to give his own whip counts of the Democratic caucus at this point in time. But the reason why I say the answer is no is, one, you can obviously look at the public comments of the Speaker over the last couple of days, the public comments of House Intelligence Committee Chairman Adam Schiff, but they're too far down the path at this point, right? There's no turning back given the fact they've had the closed-door depositions, they've had the public hearings. And along those lines, the reason why is they believe the evidence is there. You talk to Democrats kind of up and down the board. It's not a monolithic caucus. But for the most part, they believe they have enough evidence to move forward. They believe they don't have to wait for people like John Bolton to see if they can win court cases to get people like Mick Mulvaney in and testify, some of his deputies as well. They believe the time is now and they have enough to move forward, and therefore they're comfortable with where they are. Now, I will say, two Democrats voted against the House impeachment resolution last month. There is every chance that those two Democrats, Jeff Van Drew and Colin Peterson from moderate districts who are in tough re-election races, may vote against it again. But for the most part, Democrats feel good about where they are, or at least acknowledge that where they are now, there's no place else to go but forward.
What about looking forward to what happens within the Senate? Because we know Trump's allies on Capitol Hill, they're working with the White House to prepare for that likely Senate impeachment trial. What would that even look like, Phil?
So something really important happened yesterday while everybody was watching the hearings, and rightfully so, everybody was watching the hearings. But Senate Republicans, who for the last couple of weeks have really had a lot of conversations and closed-door lunches inside their conference about what this would actually look like, a core group of them, five of them, met with the White House counsel, Pat Cipollone, to start kind of working through the structure of what the White House would like to see, what Senate Republicans would like to see about a Senate trial going forward. Now, to be perfectly clear, there are no technical rules as to how a Senate trial would look like. With the Clinton impeachment, both the Republican and Democratic leader got together, worked on a bipartisan resolution, and actually kind of laid the structure out that way. That's what they want to do here. But what Republicans are doing with the White House right now is trying to get a sense. What does the president want? What is he willing to accept? What can they bring to the table as those negotiations start? Things are starting to happen in the Senate, and that just underscores the entire point of all of this. The House is going to impeach President Trump, likely before Christmas.
Phil Mattingly, thank you very much. Caitlin is back with me from the White House. Let me bring in two other voices here in New York. Samantha Vinograd, CNN national security analyst and former senior official for President Obama's National Security Council, and Ellie Honig, CNN legal analyst and former assistant U.S. attorney for the Southern District of New York. Now, Caitlin just set us up, but I want to talk to you two. John Bolton. I mean, I get it that he's saying the White House kept me from tweeting my personal account, but what about talking on Capitol Hill, talking on TV, writing an opinion piece? What's going on?
Brooke, this is such a lame excuse. I mean, John Bolton knows better than anybody that there are so many other platforms to speak up or speak out. Previous officials, when they leave any administration, revert to a different Twitter account. He obviously would have gained following. He could have written an op-ed. He could actually have gone to Capitol Hill and spoken with lawmakers. Pretending that he didn't speak up because his Twitter account was blocked is frankly just lame. It appears that he's really speaking to an audience of one here. For one, he makes clear to note in his tweets that he resigned, which is something that the president has discounted. And it really feels like he's taunting Trump and trying to trigger him into launching into some kind of Twitter tirade. Now, John Bolton has been the subject of a lot of witness testimony, and he now has something to respond to. Witnesses like Fiona Hill and Lieutenant Colonel Vindman have made allegations about John Bolton's behavior, both with respect to telling them to speak with the lawyers, and he now has something again to respond to. So this timing is quite interesting, and we'll see if he chooses to speak up in other fora as well.
You know, interestingly, you were just in my office and we were chatting about Bolton, and you were saying, you know, despite all these White House folks or former White House folks who've been subpoenaed, he has yet to be subpoenaed. Do you think?
Something's going on.
What's up?
He wants to, it seems he wants to talk. It seems he's also waiting for something. As Sam said, he had a million different ways he could have gotten word out there. And what he has to say could be so important. Here's what I come back to. Tim Morrison testified earlier in this proceeding, and he said there came a point when Bolton had a one-on-one with Donald Trump because Bolton was trying to convince him to release the foreign aid. And Morrison doesn't know what happened inside that room, but he said when Bolton came out, basically the reaction was, he's not ready yet. I want to know what happened in that room. That is crucial.
You're not the
only
one.
It is, and you know, it's worth noting, John Bolton is a hardliner, he's a hawk, but he's not a criminal. And so his testimony, or him speaking up in whatever fora, could be quite interesting because, number one, he'll speak about the security impacts of what President Trump did, how dangerous this was from a national security perspective, but he also is one of the potential direct links between President Trump and these activities. And finally, Brooke, let's remember, he went to Kyiv, he met with Ukrainian officials, so he also has firsthand evidence or testimony about how the Ukrainians felt.
No, he's a key player, obviously. Caitlin, could he still testify?
That's a big question. Is he someone who's going to surprise everyone, come testify before Democrats wrap up their part of this and what they're doing before this moves on to the Senate trial? But of course, right now, it has not been likely. It's been tied up in the courts. The White House has been essentially believing that is something that's not going to happen, that it's not something they're going to worry about, because essentially what John Bolton is putting at risk here is John Bolton's future and his ties with the Republican Party that is obviously very closely aligned with the president. And so if he's going to be the person to bring the president down, that's not something the White House is counting on right now, given that he does know a lot, but they say that they don't believe that's something he's going to risk to help Democrats out, essentially.
Okay, let's move past John Bolton. And Ellie, you know, just for everyone who's been paying attention, I think a lot of people are wondering, okay, so the testimony is finished. What now? How do you get from point A to point Z, Z being the full House vote?
Okay, impeachment in 45 seconds.
Go.
All right. The House Judiciary Committee has to put out a public report. I think they're going to do some sort of presentation as well. Schiff would be smart to do that. That report then goes over to House Judiciary Committee. That's Jerry Nadler. The Judiciary Committee then considers which articles of impeachment to put out for the whole House. The full House then votes. You need a majority of the full House. 233 Democrats right now, they can lose 15 votes and still have a majority. Then the president is impeached. Goes over to the Senate. The Senate holds a trial. Phil just gave us some insight what the trial looks like. You need two-thirds of the Senate, 67 out of 100 senators, to vote to convict. If they convict, then the president is immediately removed from office and the vice president moves up.